Psychology is all around us. Psychological elements can be seen throughout the lifespan, from birth until death. Films are a wonderful tool to explain psychological theory and occurrences in our lives. Characters interact within each frame of film psychological concepts. The films we remember most and view multiple times engage us by capturing the presence of these psychological dynamics in an authentic way. Without us even noticing through entertainment, films foster an exploration of psychology which has the potential to expand our thoughts as to what may be possible in our relationships with others, with ourselves, in our characters, our careers, in love, and in life. I invite you to join me, Dr. Catherine Marshall Woods, licensed clinical psychologist and film consultant, and my guest today, Dr. Tamika Damond, creator and film director of Believe Psychology Film Festival, to discuss the best psychology in film. Welcome, Dr. Damond. How are you today?
I'm good. It's so good to be here.
Yes, I'm so happy you had an opportunity to meet with us today to talk about Believe Psychology Film Festival. Can you tell us a little bit about you and the film festival?
Yes. So I am a licensed clinical psychologist as well, and I have a private practice in downtown Los Angeles. And as I was sort of going to some festivals, as I was a psychological consultant on films that I had sort of been connected to, I got a chance to experience the film festival circuit. And I thought to myself, you know what? I think there should be one that connects psychology and film, because this is very important to make sure that people understand the psychological concepts that get shown in film, as well as filmmakers understand some of the psychological concepts and really what they are. So that was really the passion behind starting the festival.
How has it progressed from year one to now?
Oh, wow. So the first year was supposed to happen in 2020 in May. And as you all know, in March, something very different happened, which didn't allow the festival to be live. So we ended up having it in June, which was outside of the window of May Mental Health Awareness Month. And that was sort of the aim, but it worked out fine. And we had it online, and I had some reservations, but it actually was a wonderful experience where people was just so happy that it was being done. What I noticed in terms of some of the feedback that came back is that there were lots of people who had made films. And as they submitted it to festivals, a lot of the content of the festival was just, you know, everything and all. And people really felt very happy and grateful that there was this niche where the films were sort of focused on psychology. So I got really good feedback the first year, and people were really excited about it. So that was really warming to the heart.
Yes, I can imagine that would allow you to keep going.
Yeah, it was very motivating.
Yes. So this is fantastic that we have this platform to be able to think about film specifically through psychology. So every single film that's submitted, it sounds like the creators are thoughtful that there's a psychological element.
Sometimes. I think that the description of the festival focuses on compassionate and honest representations of psychology, right? So a lot of the media that you may see, some of the more popular media that's on TV or in movies, don't always show or represent psychology in a favorable light. And that really was part of the mission, which is like, yeah, let's celebrate the films that do. Because what happens is that if you think about the medical field, if there's lots of representations that is having something be negative toward, you know, getting help and seeking help, then how does that work with psychology? Then that means that sometimes in psychology, people may be afraid to seek help because what they're seeing on TV are things that are unfavorable. So because the film festival had that mission, what people sometimes see when they submit is just psychology. And they may submit films that are literally not what the festival is about. So sometimes that does happen. But that's the screening. You go through and you screen, and what's chosen are the films that do have that representation. Now, oftentimes the filmmakers are really wonderful in the way that they give a representation that is so authentic and intimate and unique. And if you think about a first year psychology student, they may be very into psychology, but they may have never seen someone who's psychotic, someone who's struggling with bipolar symptoms, someone who's deeply suicidal or depressed. And that film that gets shown shows that character doing that. So it's such a win-win experience. And I like to think of it as a marriage. It's such a win-win experience of both industries learning from each other.
You know, Dr. Damon, I think that the way you describe this is so beautiful. And I say that because I end up having these sorts of conversations with screenwriters and producers all the time when I'm consulting on films, is that when they're creating their characters, are they being authentic and genuine with what psychological dynamics are being shown? Like, for an example, an individual who has psychosis, would a person actually behave this way? Or be perceiving the world in this way? Will they navigate their life this way with others and be able to put that on the spectrum for them to be able to think about while they're creating their characters? Because how important is it for individuals within film in particular to have this space to educate the public regarding mental health? And they have such a powerful view and reach for people. People watch films, people watch media. So they have all of this space and this captivated audience to be able to educate people on mental health. It's so important that the accuracy of what people are watching is there.
Yes, and I will say the psychosis, there was a category that was best psychosis film. And you know, the films that were coming in really struggled with understanding what that was. There was a lot of people actually that had personal stories, and those are actually the really nice ones because they sort of told their journey either through a documentary or a narrative short film where they talked about what their experiences was. And those you really see some of the more expressive and authentic ways that some of these diagnostic pieces do pan out. But then some of the ones that are just sort of trying to tell a story, you'll get these films that always have this shocker at the end. And sometimes that shocker is like, clinically, that's not how really it happens, you know? So,
well, and that's media, right? People want to be captivated. So they try to give you just a smidge more than maybe what reality may actually offer. Which is how entertainment happens.
And you're actually making an interesting point, because when I go and I tell people, hey, this is a psychology film festival, what's the first thing that you think about? Oh, it's going to be depressing. It's going to be diagnostic. It's going to be mental health and psychology, right? It's the Believe Psychology Film Festival, not mental health, right? So oftentimes psychology is very broad. And so there are films that are not just about mental health and about mental illness. It's about psychology within itself. It's about love and friendship and relationships and understanding how there's dynamics that work and interpersonal, you know, experiences. And I think that's what makes it wonderful, is that we have themes on hope and happiness and resiliency and recovery and these more sort of well-being and joyful moments of psychology. So what we do with the categories in terms of the themes and how we group the films when people come to the festival is that we have five ways that we show it, right? We have the resiliency and hope and all the films that sort of are within, you know, sort of represent those dynamics. And then we have compassionate and honest. Those are the ones that you'll tend to get the more, you know, mental health related, diagnostic related. We have diversity because that's very, very important to show films that have, you know, characters of color, that have groups of people that you may not be familiar with in terms of how their lives roll out, like let's say for like veterans or something of that sort. And then we have spreading awareness because documentaries are very popular to really understand like the background of how some special population is coming about. And then lastly, cinematically captivating. It's sort of a fun way of putting it. And that has to do with being able to negotiate, balance the entertainment aspect, as well as trying to get your topic explained. So that's sort of how we, you know, make it happen.
Yes. Well, this will be a great time to actually be able to take a quick break. When we return, we'll continue to talk with you, Dr. Damond, about Believe Psychology Film Festival. We'll also have an opportunity to watch a short clip of a film that was the 2020 award-winning Best Short Film by Pin Young Jin. So this is quite exciting. So just hold on one moment and we'll be right back.
I do love what I do for a living. I never dreamed that having this career was possible until I came to UDC. I met a professor when I decided to finish up my degree program. She told me, hey, why don't you go and intern on Capitol Hill? The internship led to being a staffer. I would have never been open up to that opportunity if that professor would have never urged me and said, you know, I see something in you. My UDC experience changed my life. UDC helped me find my possible.
Find your possible. Visit udc.edu/possible to learn more.
Do you want to meet a family with a transgender kid? Here we are. Max loves to do backflips. Max loves to play his ukulele. Max loves to just be a kid and just be himself. When I found out I was pregnant, all I really wanted was a happy, healthy, whole child. And that's what I got. I think it's really important for people to know that trans kids don't have a political agenda. They are just kids. Like any parent, we love our kids unconditionally, and we will never stop fighting for them. Stand with us. Protect our families.
Hi. Can I get the now bar, please?
No problem. $1.
Have a good one.
Got it.
Hi, can I get a now bar, please? Uh-huh.
$1.
Thanks.
Hey, what's going on?
Hey.
Hey, let me get a now bar.
Sure. $1.
Appreciate you.
You got it.
How's it going?
Can I get a now bar?
Hey, stop right there! Get down on the ground! Out of your car right now! Get down!
Over your head!
Get down on the ground!
All right,
all right.
Get
Welcome back. Today we're talking with Dr. Tamika Damond, Film Festival Director of Believe Psychology Film Festival. Let's look at a portion of the 2020 Best Short Award-winning film, Second Parent by Pin Young Jin, and we'll discuss what we see on the other side.
5, 6, 7, 8. Oh my goodness, a whole second longer than yesterday. Good job, honey.
Your turn, Mama.
Oh, you know I can't beat you.
But you never played the game with me, please.
Okay. Why don't we play duckies instead?
This is me.
This is me.
No, silly, it's Mommy.
Oh.
Is somebody calling Mommy?
Mommy!
Oh, hey. How was your day with Mama, honey? I missed you so much. And you?
Yeah. Go get some food. I'll put her to bed later.
Okay.
But I want Mommy to read stories. You promised me you still read stories.
I know, honey. I'm sorry. Becca, honey, remember? We talked about this. Mommy's going back to work now, so she needs to get her rest.
It's okay, babe. Let me put her to bed tonight.
Are you sure? I totally can do it if you're tired.
100%.
Yay!
What story do you want to read tonight, honey?
A dragon.
A dragon? Which dragon?
A happy birthday dragon.
Happy birthday dragon. Do you want to make our own story up then? You know, I made real food. It's in the fridge. That stuff will kill you.
Sorry, babe. This is just faster.
Wow. So, how's work? You crushing it yet or what?
I wish. I used to be so good at it, but now I feel so dumb and old around these young professionals.
Is she better today?
Yeah. Everything is under control.
Really?
Except some crying and asking for mommy moments.
But I get that. Her anxiety is totally normal considering you were the birth mother and you stayed at home.
Babe. She's four.
Just give her some time. You're doing great, okay? Do you think we should tell Becca about Dylan, since he's coming? We'll be creative. I know she's four.
Right, she's four.
All right, well, I'm here whenever you think it's time. Just don't overthink it, okay?
Funny, weren't you the one who did the overthinking when I suggested we use him as our donor?
Yes, And it is the best decision we have ever made. She has your eyes, your quiet strength.
Oh no,
not tonight, please. Oh no.
You remember it. We spent so much time on it. Okay, box.
Box.
Nope, not on my
box.
Foot. Not my foot.
Let's just sway.
Thank you.
We've just viewed a clip from the movie Second Parent by Pin Young Chin, which is an example of many psychological factors. Some that what I had gathered from could relate to trauma, relate to parent-child relationships. And I'm wondering, Dr. Damond, what made this become one of the films that was accepted in the film festival, but also that won Best Short?
Oh, yes. So there's just so many topics that had been approached in the films that had been submitted as well that won awards. And what I like particular about this one is that, you know, it didn't focus only on having a lesbian marriage and relationship that had a child, but some of the really, the complexity of how that parental roles played out. So when the filmmaker made it, I don't know if she referenced research, but I like to sort of be a nerd about things and actually research about children's preference of their parents when it has the same sex relationships, right? And that for mothers and for women in particular, there's a natural inclination within the parent, the biological parent, and especially when there's nursing, that the child is then more bonded, just initially in the beginning, especially in the clip, you had seen a mother who had stayed home for the first 3 years. So that child really had that more bond to that parent. And then when they switched roles and that parent went back to, the biological mother went back to work, you now have the parent that you saw in the clip that was really struggling with wanting to feel connected. And the research had pointed out that most times that non-biological mother will have feelings of alienation, separation, and, you know, detachment, a way of perhaps feeling a little, you know, not good about things in a really simplistic way. And you can see that just by, and this is where the film, the acting, the directing, this is the part where, you know, they made some really good choices, because you have that academic piece, you have that piece where it's meaningful toward the mission. And then there was such a subtleness in her facial expressions. You know, they didn't have to, like, you know, really you know, be all out. There was just the acting was so good. And the way that they zeroed in on, you know, something that of the topic when it has to do with lesbian relationships is something that may not be talked about, right? That people may not be well versed in understanding those dynamics. And so the fact that they brought that to life and they did it in a way that was captivating. They did it in a way that as you see the rest of the film, I mean, really, really touch your heart as you see these characters try to negotiate and work it out. And, you know, by the end of the film, the non-biological parent really, really struggled. I mean, to the point where she had a breakdown and the biological mother was so supportive, but it didn't matter, right?
That's actually, you know, I'm so glad you're bringing this to light. That is one thing that I was very taken by within this film is how supportive the biological mother was in being able to champion this, the other mother to say, you know, she's going to love you. She loves you. She'll return to you. She'll be here. And how that doesn't necessarily then land on the person who's struggling, even though family support is really important for mental health resilience. It's important for mental health repair and healing. And even still, that love that's given doesn't always land on an individual. And I know that when we talk to people specifically who love individuals who are having psychological challenges, they say, what can I do? And we always talk about that support and being there again to champion them more and to support them through times. And then it's so hard for other individuals to say, well, I don't feel like it's landing well on them.
Sometimes they just have to go through it, right? They just have to go through it. Now, again, I don't know if the director made this conscious choice, but back to the research is that there's actually like the child was turning four, right? She was three and turning four. But there's actually research that says at 3.5, that as the toddler then becomes more aware, more assertive and more verbal, that the preference becomes to be more dominant and more seen. And so this is actually a thing, but by 5, they go out of it and they're able to bond equally with both parental figures and sort of have a relationship with both mothers. So it's just interesting that, again, whether intended or not intended, you know, these films give this light and give this representation, this portrayal, this image of these things that are true psychological principles and dynamic and enriched in research. And I just find that incredibly fascinating.
See, this, I'm going to go back to the point made earlier of how important filmmakers are to us in our understanding of the world, is that they have such a powerful opportunity to be able to educate the research and be able to illustrate that through this art form and be able to help people to be able to at least put this in their radar and on their minds of saying, okay, when I see parents of same-sex couples, this may be what one of them may be feeling right now with a 3.5 or 4-year-old child. And how maybe can I support them? Or at least maybe I should ask them, how's things going? Yeah. And be there to be able to support them because they've had now second parent in mind. When they think about this film, they think, how can I even support some of my friends now?
And then let's say that's from a social support perspective. For all of the mental health professionals out there, if there were any counseling of couples that were anywhere remotely within this experience and their family dynamics, they may see it as, you know, the couple conflict, right? And then, you know, with this idea of this keen eye now and being exposed to perhaps this film, probably this film more than maybe the research article that I had found, right? That they could then see and say, hey, I wonder if this may be happening as you talk about the conflict in your relationship. I wonder what is your dynamics in terms of how you relate to your child? And they may pick up on something that had not been spoken in the therapy room. They may ask a question that had not been thought about and then can be considered within the couple as parents. And so that's why, again, this becomes incredibly important to highlight these films, to celebrate these films and help them as independent and new filmmakers put out their work, so that it can get to the masses.
I could not agree with you more. I know, Dr. Damon, we've run out of time. How can individuals be a part of Believe Psychology Film Festival? How can they find it? When does it happen? Tell us.
So it's coming up. So that's very exciting. Go to the website, www.BelievePsychologyFilmFest.com. And the festival is happening May 20 to 22, 2022, and it looks, see all those twos and zeros, I love it, right? And then it's happening in Los Angeles live. There's actually a live component where on that Saturday the 21st we'll show some shorts, and on that Sunday the 22nd we'll show features. And then, because some people may still feel uncomfortable traveling, that you can enjoy it in your home, all of the 3 days, all of the films, and an online platform. So you can buy tickets for one or the other or both. So
wonderful. Well, I am hopeful individuals will actually either attend and or virtually attend. This is a wonderful way to be able to see psychology come to life through this artwork of film, which is of course both of our passions, Dr. Damon. Yes. So it's such a pleasure to have had you on today.
And for myself as well.
Well, we will see you next time on Best Psychology in Film. Have a good day. Mm-hmm.